Hey guys, I am Venkat and this is part 20 of Web Development with Blazor video series. In our previous video, we discussed how to perform CRUD operations using Blazor DataGrid. It's a powerful and easy to use component. Out of the box, it provides several customizations so we can very easily and quickly implement most of the real-world application use cases. At the moment, when we try to edit one of these rows, notice the edit row is put in line in the data grid itself. We provide values for each of these fields and then click the update button to update the data in the underlying database table. Similarly, when we try to add a new row, again, this new row is placed in line in the data grid itself. Same idea, we provide the values for these fields and then click the update button. So basically, everything is done in line in the data grid itself. But what if I want to perform both the add and update operations in a separate dialog instead of in line in the grid? Well, out of the box, DataGrid supports three edit modes: normal, dialog, and batch. What we saw just now in action is the default normal edit mode. Now, to explicitly set edit mode on this grid edit settings component, we set mode property, and the value for this is edit mode enum. And as you can see from IntelliSense, it has three values: batch, dialog, normal. The default, if we don't explicitly set edit mode, is normal, and we have seen that in action just now. Let's try dialog. Now, when we try to edit a row, notice the edit row is in a separate dialog instead of in line in the data grid. Let's provide new values. And then click save. Data updated in the grid. Let's confirm if the update really made its way to the underlying database table by executing this select query and take a look at this first row. Data updated as expected. Now, this edit mode dialog is highly customizable. At the top, we have the dialog header. Notice the text that we have at the moment, details of 2. This value 2 is the primary key value. In our case, employee ID value. Now, to make it a bit more meaningful, I want to change this header text to details of whatever is the first name of the employee. In this case, the first name is Sam, so we want to display the text details of Sam. Similarly, in the footer, we have these two buttons, save and cancel. Whether I'm editing an existing employee record or adding a new record, in both the cases, the text on the button is save. We want to change it to add when we are adding a new employee row and to update when we are updating an existing employee row. So let's see how to customize both the dialog header and footer. To customize the dialog header, inside this grid edit settings component, we use header template. Inside this header template, let's include a span element, and in here we want to display the header text. For that, we're going to call a separate method called getHeaderText. We don't have this method yet. We'll create it in just a bit. And to this method, we want to pass the employee object that we are trying to edit. And remember, inside the data grid, we have access to an implicit parameter called context, and we can typecast this parameter to employee type because our data grid is binding to a list of employee objects. Our obvious next step is to create this method. So let's do that in the code block at the bottom right here. Return type of our new method is string because it's going to return the header text. The name of our method is getHeaderText, and to this we pass the employee object that we are editing. Let's call the parameter also employee. If employee.employeeID equals 0, this means we are creating a new employee. So we want to return add new employee. Else, we are editing an existing employee, so we want to return edit whatever is the employee first name, and to get employee first name, employee.firstname details. Oh, we forgot to wrap the string in double quotes. Now, when we edit an employee record, notice the header text, edit employee first name details. And when we are adding a new employee row, notice it is add new employee. Now, let's customize the text that we have on the save button in the dialog footer. When we are adding a new employee, we want the text to be add when editing and updating update. To customize edit dialog footer, just like header template, we also have footer template. In here, we need two buttons, save and cancel. For that, first let's bring in the buttons namespace, syncfusion.blazor.buttons. And in the footer template, let's include save and cancel buttons. We don't have these two event handlers, so let's create them in the code block. When cancel button is clicked, we want to cancel editing and close the dialog. So for that, we call close edit method on the employee grid. And when we click the save button, we want to save added or edited record and then close the dialog. So for that, we call end edit on employee grid. Now, if you're wondering, what is this employee grid property? Well, if you remember, it's a property that we created in our previous video right here. And this is the property that we have set as the value for ref attribute on our data grid itself right here. So this property holds a reference to our grid. So we can call methods like end edit, close edit, refresh, etc. on the grid. And then if you take a look at this button right here, we are at the moment hard coding the text to save. Now we want to dynamically change this to add and update depending on when we are adding or updating an employee record. So instead of hard coding the text here, let's bind it to a variable and let's call this variable save button text. We don't have this variable yet. We'll create it in just a bit. Now it is this method that dynamically sets our dialog header text. So we can make use of the same method to dynamically set the button text as well. So let's scroll down to get header text method. When adding a new employee, button text must be add, and when updating an employee, it must be update. Finally, let's not forget to declare this save button text property. That's the reason we have these compilation errors. So let's create our property right here. The property type is string and the name of the property is save button text. Now, when we try to add a new employee, the button text is add, and when we try to edit, it's update. Finally, let's try batch mode. This is even more interesting. In batch mode, as the name implies, changes are made in batch. For example, to this data grid, I can add 5 rows, edit 3 rows, delete 2 rows. And then when I click update, that's when all these changes are made in batch, not individually. Notice when I double click on a row to edit, the entire row is not in edit mode. Only the specific cell where I clicked is in edit mode. I can change the value and then press the tab key. Notice the green background color indicates that a change is made but is not saved yet. Similarly, I can change the last name, press the tab key, date of birth, same idea. We have a small issue with department column. We'll come to that in just a bit. Now, when I double click on gender column, again, I can change gender value. And then when I press the tab key, again, we have a green background color indicating the value is changed but not saved yet. With department, notice again, when I double click, the cell is in edit mode. At the moment, the selected value is IT. Let's change it to admin. And then when I click on any other cell, you know, the row gets out of edit mode, but notice it still has the old department, which is IT. But again, if I put the cell in edit mode by clicking it, now we can see in edit mode, it has the value that we have changed. But when we get out of edit mode, we see the old value. So let's fix this bug first. At the moment, department grid column is being bound to department.departmentName property. Let's actually bind it to employee.departmentID property. So for that, we'll use a syntax to similar to what we have right here using @nameOf keyword. And then we want to bind to department.id property. Now, in the department column, we see department IDs. but for an end user, department names make more sense. So in the grid column, just like this edit template, let's include template. Now we want a method to which we pass department ID value and it returns us the department name. And then we'll call that method here inside the template, so it displays the department name. So let's first write that method in the code block right here. Return type is string because it returns us the department name. Let's name the method getDepartmentById, and we need to pass it department ID. Now, this departments property already contains the list of all departments, so we're going to use it to retrieve the department by ID. So departments dot first or default d dot department ID equals whatever is the incoming ID, and what do we want from it? We want the department name, so we simply want to return this from this method. But we also want to make a check if this incoming ID value is zero. That means the employee does not have a department yet, and in that case we simply want to return null. So let's do an if check. If ID equals zero, return null, else we want to return the department name. All that is left is to call this method inside the template. Let's include a span element, and then we want to call our method get department name by ID. And to this method, we have to pass the department ID. And remember, inside the grid, we have access to an implicit parameter called context. Let's typecast it to employee, and then we can get the employee department ID. Now, let's put this department cell in edit mode, change it from IT to admin, and then when I press the tab key, we see the changed value, and we also have the green background color indicating that the cell value is changed. Let's also change gender, first name and last name. And let's also perform a delete. So let's delete this employee row with ID 9. So we select the row, click the delete button. So at the moment in the grid, we have an update and delete. Before I click the update button, let's go to Visual Studio, and in the output window, make sure you have your web server selected, and let's delete all the SQL commands that are already logged, and then let's click update. We have a dialog, click OK. Looks like the changes are saved, but then if we take a look at the output window in Visual Studio, notice none of the update or delete SQL statements are logged here. This means the changes are not saved in the underlying database table. This also means, notice what happens when we reload the web page. All our changes are reverted. Notice this employee row with ID 1, we have the changes undone. And if you remember, we deleted this employee row with ID 9. Again, this is back. So now what we want to do is save these changes in the underlying database table as well. Now, here's the important point to keep in mind. When we click update button in the data grid to batch save data, on batch save event is raised. So this is the event we want to handle to save changes in the underlying database table. So in the grid events component, we want to handle on batch save. Let's name the event handler batch save handler. We don't have this method yet, so let's create it right here. This method receives a parameter of type before batch save args. At this point, you might be wondering, how do I know I have to pass an object of this type? Well, IntelliSense is your friend. So if we scroll all the way up to the event, and when I hover the mouse over this on batch save, you can see from IntelliSense, the event handler method takes a parameter of type before batch save args of t value. In our case, the type of value our grid is binding to is employee object. That's why they're using a parameter of type before batch save args of employee object. Create a variable, name it updates, and then on the incoming args parameter, we have batch changes, and on that, we have changed records. this property returns the list of all updates. Similarly, deleted records returns all deleted records, and added records returns all the added records. So let's hold on to changed records in this updates variable. Similarly, we have inserts and deletes. And then let's use a for each loop. Employee, let's also call the loop variable employee in updates. We already have our client-side employee service injected. So on the employee service, we have update employee method. And to this, let's pass the employee object. Similarly, process inserts and deletes. And let's not forget to use await keyword, because update employee is an async method. Let's save our changes and take a look at the browser. Let's edit this first row, change first name and last name. Let's delete this employee row with ID 9. And let's also add a new employee row. First name, batch 1, last name, batch 2. Include a random date of birth, department, admin, gender, female. And let's set the email to batch1@batch1.com. And then before we click update, let's clear everything that we have in the output window. And then click update. Click OK. And if we take a look at Visual Studio, notice we have our updates and inserts and deletes here. Before we wrap up, on this grid edit settings, I'm going to set allow next row edit to true. This is false by default. When I double click on this first name cell, it's in edit mode. When I press the tab key, it moves on to the next cell. As I keep pressing the tab key, it moves to the last cell in the first row. At this point, when I press the tab key again, notice it advances to the first cell in the second row. But this ID column is not editable. So the grid is smart enough not to put this cell in edit mode. When I press the tab key again, it moves on to the second cell in the second row. To go back, I press shift tab. Notice from second cell, we moved on to the first cell in the second row. At this point, when I press shift tab again, we go to the last cell in the previous column. In our case, last cell in the first row. So by setting this property, allow next row edit to true, basically we are able to advance editing from one row to the next by pressing the tab key. If we want to move in the opposite direction, use shift tab. That's it in this video. Thank you for listening.